Okay. So, and then we'll talk about the combinations of with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and with fulvestrant and toxicity profile and emerging data and question and answer. So, as you know, that breast cancer is the most common cancer worldwide. And the most common subtypes of breast cancer is hormone receptor positive HER2 negative breast cancer, comprising of 73% of breast cancer based on US data in 2010. And 6% of patients present with metastatic disease at presentation, I mean de novo metastatic disease, and up to 50% with primary breast cancer will later develop metastatic disease. And till now, currently, metastatic disease is considered an incurable but treatable disease, especially with new medications. So in Saudi Arabia, as you can see here clearly, it is the number one for the incidence in the female, counting for 30% of female malignancy. And there is 2,240 new female breast cancer diagnosed in 2016. And 40% of these cases are localized, 40% are regional disease, and 12%, unfortunately, diagnosed with de novo metastatic disease. And this percentage of de novo metastatic disease is stable for a long time since the initiation of Saudi Cancer Registry. So now we're talking about changing the outlook of management of metastatic breast cancer and how we will choose the first line treatment options for patients with hormone receptor positive HER2 negatives. As we know that endocrine therapy is the recommended first line, even in the presence of visceral metastasis. And although endocrine therapy is limited by endocrine resistance, first line use is associated with similar efficacy in overall survival and first line chemotherapy in the real world conditions. And the most important thing is less toxic and better quality of life compared with chemotherapy. And this is very important if you are dealing with patients with incurable disease who will have the treatment for life. But still, there is a clinical need to improve the benefits of the first line endocrine therapy. On the other hand, chemotherapy is not recommended for hormone receptor positive HER2 negative metastatic breast cancer, unless in certain circumstances where patients failed multiple lines of endocrine therapy or patients display signs of visceral crisis. And the definition of visceral crisis is very questionable nowadays in the presence of CDK4/6 inhibitors. And chemotherapy associated with significant and often debilitating side effect and worse quality of life. And by delaying chemotherapy, we are maintaining patient quality of life by minimizing treatment toxicity by giving the patients endocrine therapy upfront. So this slide shows you the evolving treatment landscape of hormone receptor positive advanced breast cancer. We have tamoxifene, which was started since 1970. And in 1990s, we have three aromatase inhibitors, letrozole, anastrozole, and exemestane. And then in 2002, fulvestrant was introduced to the market. And in 2010, we know that high-dose fulvestrant is superior to the low-dose fulvestrant. And then in 2012, everolimus, which is an mTOR inhibitor, showed a positive result in Boliro trials, though associated with significant toxicity. And then we have the three CDK4/6 inhibitors started in 2016 by palbociclib, and then in 2017 by ribociclib and abemaciclib. And lastly, last year, we have abelacimab for patients who progressed on CDK4/6 inhibitor and they are having mutations in PIK3 alpha. And still, the future is ongoing and evolving. So this is a diagram show you the mechanism of actions of all of these therapies for hormone receptor positive metastatic breast cancer. And up to 50% hormone receptor positive metastatic breast cancer do not benefit from endocrine therapy due to resistance. And mechanism of resistance is a difference and may include alterations of ER expression, overexpression, or activations of growth factor receptor, or activations of downstream signal transduction pathway. So just to go to give a close up for CDK4/6 inhibitor, because it's our, topic for today. So in the ER positive breast cancer, the presence of estrogen causes overactivate signaling of protein within the nucleus. And then growth of hormone receptor boost metastatic cancer dependent on cyclin D1, which is a direct transcriptional target for the estrogen receptor. Cyclin D1 activate cyclin CDK4 and CDK6, resulting in G1S phase transition and cell cycle entry. So what is the CDK4/6 inhibitor is doing? By selectively inhibiting CDK4/6, causes cell cycle arrest in the G1 phase, resulting in reduced cell viability and tumor shrinkage, and this result in clinical improvement, progression-free survival, and even overall survival in some study. So we'll go to the clinical trials for the first line for CDK4/6 inhibitors. I will not go in details for all of these trials, but as you know, we have three approved CDK4/6 inhibitor in the first line. We have palbociclib based on Paloma trial, Paloma 2 trial. We have ribociclib based on three MONALEESA trial, MONALEESA 2, which is used letrozole as endocrine partner in the first line only. MONALEESA 7, which used any endocrine partner, tamoxifen, letrozole, or anastrozole. And you have MONALEESA 3, which is tested in the first and second line setting with fulvestrant. And the third CDK4/6 inhibitor is abemaciclib, based on MONARCH 3 trial, and the endocrine partner is letrozole or anastrozole. And as you can see here clearly, the hazard ratio is almost similar in all these five clinical trials, with a hazard ratio of 0.5 in almost, it is universal in all of these five trials with three CDK4/6 inhibitor, with a progression-free survival improved up to 33 months in some trial, with objective response rate reaching up to 55%. So I'll just show you the clinical design of this trial. So this is the Paloma 2 study, which is tested postmenopausal women with no prior endocrine therapy for palbociclib, 1.5 milligram, 3 weeks on, 1 week off, plus letrozole, versus placebo plus letrozole, with primary endpoint progression-free survival, and secondary endpoint, the most important one, is overall survival. Similar design for MONALEESA 2, but it is for ribociclib with letrozole, with similar endpoints. MONALEESA 3, this is used for the first or second line setting, and the endocrine partner is fulvestrant, but similar design of the study with the primary endpoint progression-free survival, and secondary endpoint is overall survivals and others. MONALEESA 7, exactly same design, and is used for only exclusively in pre and perimenopausal women, but all patients has to receive guzerline. So we have to convert all these patients to postmenopausal by giving them guzerline, and they are using any endocrine partners, including tamoxifen, letrozole, or anastrozole, with primary endpoint progression-free survival, and a bunch of secondary endpoints. The most important one is overall survival. As all of you know, all of these trials have the similar result in improvement progression-free survival. For MONALEESA, for Paloma 2 trial, it's improved from 14 to 24 months progression-free survival with a hazard ratio of 0.58 with a significant p-value. Same result in MONALEESA, improvement of BFS from 16 to 25 months with a hazard ratio of 0.56. MONARCH also giving the same result of improvement of BFS from 14 months and is not reached in the abemaciclib plus non-steroidal aromatase inhibitor. So it's consistent across all patients and all subgroup analyzed. Monolinza 3, which used fulvestrant in the first or second line setting, shows similar results with improvement of progression-free survival from 19 to 33 in the first line setting and from 9 months to 14 months in the second line setting, or early relapse with a significant hazard ratio and a significant p-value. This slide shows you that all subgroups get benefit of combinations of CDK4/6 inhibitors and endocrine therapy, and this is examples of Paloma 2 and MONALEESA 2 trials. What about improvement of overall survival in the first setting? Is CDK4/6 inhibitor improve overall survival? The short answer is yes. This is the data from MONALEESA 2 trial, which compared ribociclib plus letrozole versus placebo plus letrozole. And we can see here, after 2 years, after 24 months, we see very clear separations of the curves. And as we know that endocrine therapy patients, they have late progressions. That's why we need more times, more years to see the result for overall survivals. And the median is 33 months in placebo arm and is not reached yet in the ribociclib plus letrozole arm. And the data is not yet mature for MONALEESA 2 trial. The only mature data we have for MONALEESA 3 and clearly shows improvement of overall survival between placebo arm and ribociclib arm. The median in the placebo is 40 months, is not reached in the ribociclib arm with a hazard ratio of 0.7 with a significant p-value of 0.04, which crossed pre-specified boundary for superiority. The overall survival is maintained in MONALEESA 3, either if it is used as a first line or used as a second line or in relapse. Also, MONALEESA 7, which used any endocrine partner, showed improvement in overall survival with a significant p-value of 0.09. And again, also here, you can see the clear separation of the curve start after 2 years, with 29% relative reduction in the risk of death, and the p-value also crossed the specified boundary for superiority efficacy. So which endocrine partner is the best in the first line setting to use aromatase inhibitor or fulvestrant? This question is tried to be answered by Parsifal trial, which was presented in June of this year in the virtual ASCO 2020, which is a randomized multicenter open label phase 2 trial to evaluate the palbociclib in combination with fulvestrant or letrozole in endocrine sensitive patients with estrogen receptor HER2 negative breast cancer. This is the study design. They randomized patients to fulvestrant 500 milligram on day 1, 14, 29, and then monthly plus palbociclib versus letrozole plus palbociclib till treatment progression. The primary endpoint is progression-free survival, and secondary endpoint is overall survival. So for the primary endpoint, as you can see here clearly, both lines are overlapping, and study did not demonstrate either superiority or non-inferiority of palbociclib plus fulvestrant versus placebo, versus palbociclib plus letrozole. And there is no BFS differences in subgroups defined by visceral involvement, de novo versus recurrent metastasis. So there is no difference between in the term of progression-free survival if used fulvestrant in the first line or letrozole in the first line. Overall survival again is the similar. As you can see, it's both lines and are lying together. We'll move now to second line setting and the trial then for the second line in the CDK4/6 inhibitors after the failure of the first line if it is not used in the first line. So we have three main trials. Paloma 3 trial, which used palbociclib with a fulvestrant. Monarch trial, which used abemaciclib with fulvestrant, and Monalisa trial, Monalisa 3, as we mentioned in the first line, it was used for the first line or earlier relapse and second line setting. And 50% of the patients in the second line and 50% of the patient was de novo metastatic disease. Again, here we can see similar hazard ratio, 0.5 across all the trials. Just to tell you that there is different patient populations in this trial. For Paloma 3, they allow any numbers prior endocrine therapy, and only one prior chemotherapy is allowed. In Monarch 2, which is a abemaciclib trial, they only allow one prior endocrine therapy and no prior chemotherapy. And Monalisa 3, as you know, it is either first or second line endocrine therapy, and no prior chemotherapy is allowed. This is the study design. Patient was randomized to 2-to-1 randomization, either to palbociclib plus fulvestrant or placebo plus fulvestrant. And they have pre-specified definition for sensitivity to prior hormone therapy. And it was defined as documented clinical benefits to the prior hormone therapy regimen in the metastatic setting, or more than 24 months of adjuvant hormonal therapy before recurrence. And this is very important, as you will see, for the survival. Similar design for Monarch 2 with similar endpoints. Again, similar design for Monalisa 3 trials. This is the result for the three trials. The progression-free survival improved from 4 months to 11.2 months in Paloma 3 with a hazard ratio of 0.4 and significant p-value. Similar result in Monalisa 3, and again, similar result in Monarch 2 trial. This slide shows you that the CDK4/6 inhibitor has relatively high objective response rate. As you can see here, the objective response rate is around 55% in the first line, and it is ranging from 25 to 48% in the second line. So this has given us also when to use it. So as we can see here, the benefit is better if you use it in the first line. So if you have the chance to use it in the first line, it is recommended instead of delaying it to the second line. Also, we have overall survival in the second line setting. Monarch 2 trial showed significant improvement of overall survival from 37 months to 46 months with absolute benefit of 9 months with a hazard ratio of 0.7 and p-value of 0.1. And the median time, this is very important, so the median time to chemotherapy is also significantly prolonged from 22 months to 50 months, which is around 4 years. In Paloma 3, which is used palbociclib plus fulvestrant, there is there is non-significant trend toward improved overall survival with fulvestrant plus palbociclib, and there is suggestion of overall survival benefit, but it did not reach statistical significance with improvement of overall survival from 28 months to 34.9 months in palbociclib arm. And the improvement is more pronounced in patients who has sensitivity to prior endocrine therapy. As you can see here, it is improved from 29 to 39 months with a hazard ratio of 0.7, and is less pronounced in patients without sensitivity to prior endocrine therapy. What about using CDK4/6 inhibitors as a monotherapy? It's only approved for abemaciclib based on phase 2 trial, phase 2 Monarch 1 trial, in patients who is heavily pretreated, hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, and it showed that this patient has objective response rate of 26% with confirmed a clinical benefit of 56% of the patients, as you can see here in the graph. We have another study testing monotherapy for abemaciclib, which is called Next Monarch 1 study, which was presented in San Antonio in 2018. It has three arms. Patients with hormone receptor positive HER2 negative who are relapsed or progressed after endocrine therapy. They are heavily pretreated patients, again, with no prior CDK4 inhibitor, randomized either to abemaciclib plus tamoxifen. Second arm is abemaciclib monotherapy, and the third arm is abemaciclib plus prophylactic leuprimide. And as you know all, that more than me, that abemaciclib is associated with diarrhea. This is the most significant side effect of it. So that's why they give the third arm is abemaciclib with prophylactic leuprimide. The primary endpoint of this study is progression-free survival, and secondary endpoint is objective response rate, duration response, overall survival, and others. The result of this trial, it showed that PFS is longer with abemaciclib plus tamoxifen with a median PFS of 9.1 months compared to 6.5 months in abemaciclib monotherapy and 7.4 months in if you used prophylactic leuprimides. And there is reduced severity and incidence of diarrhea observed if you use prophylactic leuprimide with abemaciclib dose of 150 milligram, and objective response rate of abemaciclib with leuprimide is higher, improved from 19 to 28.6%. So should CDK4 inhibitor be continued by the progression? The answer is not outside the clinical trials setting. We have no trial to give us the permission to use it outside the clinical trials. This is the list of clinical trials using CDK4/6 inhibitor by the progressions, maintain 2, PACE, and TRINIT 1 trials for ribociclib and palbociclib. Still, we don't have final analysis for these results. So what about using chemotherapy? As we know all that that standard of care for endocrine for hormone receptor positive breast cancer who has no visceral crisis is endocrine therapy. But maybe some maybe argue chemotherapy is more beneficial. So this is what's answered in Yang Pearl trial, which was presented in ASCO 2019, which is a prospective multicenter open label phase 2 study by Korean group. They randomized patients who are premenopausal who received treatment with tamoxifen and less than 1 line of previous chemotherapy to either palbociclib exemestane plus leuprolide versus capecitabine. I don't know actually why they use capecitabine arm. And the primary endpoint is progression-free survival, and secondary endpoint is disease control rate or overall survival. As you can see here clearly, the endocrine therapy combination arm is superior with median progression-free survival for, is 20 months in endocrine therapy versus 14 months in capecitabine arm, with a hazard ratio of 0.65. Another trial called Pearl study, Pearl trial, which is international randomized phase 3 study with 2 cohorts. The first cohort is gigamastin plus palbociclib versus capecitabine. The second cohort is fulvestrant plus palbociclib compared to capecitabine. In this trial, the 2 co-primary endpoints were not met. So progression-free survival with palbociclib fulvestrant was not superior to capecitabine in patients with metastatic breast cancer resistant to endocrine therapy. And BFS with palbociclib plus endocrine therapy is not superior to capecitabine in patients with ESR1 wild tumor mutations. So now, I will talk just brief about the monitoring and management of toxicity related to CDK4/6 inhibitors. As you know that they are not toxicity-free, but their toxicity profile is favorable over chemotherapy. And their toxicity profile are almost similar between all of the available three CDK4/6 inhibitor. But I will just concentrate in some of them. As you can see here, diarrhea is in all the three, and it's more pronounced with abemaciclib and can be managed by antidiarrheal therapy, increased hydrations, and dose reductions. Hepatobiliary toxicity, which is mainly lab toxicity, more with abemaciclib and ribociclib. And this is very unique side effect with QT prolongations with ribociclib. Neutropenia is in all of them, but it's more with palbociclib, which can be managed. And just to mention that neutropenia here, we can call it benign neutropenia because it's not causing febrile neutropenia in the majority of cases. It's just a drop of the WBC count and the absolute neutrophil counts. VTE is more with abemaciclib. And lastly, the FDA, they launched a black box warning for interstitial lung disease and pneumonitis in all the three CDK4/6 inhibitors. This is just to show you that the most common adverse effects is grade 3 neutropenia in the Paloma 2 and Paloma 3 trials. Paloma 3 showed there is no difference in the effect of progression-free survival if patient received the full dose or dose reductions. So if patient developed side effect, dose reduction will not affect the final outcome of the drug. For the ribociclib, because it's important, if patients in the trials, there is 11 patients, which 3.3% developed QTC prolongations with ribociclib plus letrozole, and it is reversible and early, and there is one sudden cardiac death with grade 3 hypokalemia and grade 2 QTC prolongations. I will not go into details for those modifications because all of you know about this and how to manage and how to do the dose reduction, but all the three is available and the three strength and available for three dose reductions. So in conclusion, CDK4/6 inhibitor, how do you choose? So it depends actually in multiple factors based on the comorbidities, bone marrow function, cardiovascular, patient has any comorbidities in the heart, cardiac comorbidities, GI comorbidities, or patients had concomitant drugs and drug-drug interactions or other side effects. Other things is the clinician experience, and the most important, I think, is insurance or co-pays and availability of the drugs. But I think all of the drugs, all the three drugs, is working similar, and is a class effect for all the three medications. Addition of CDK4/6 inhibitor to endocrine therapy has improved outcome hormone receptor positive HER2-negative metastatic breast cancer. The median progression-free survival improved more than 20 months in first-line settings and 17 months in second-line setting with consistent hazard ratio across all the study, and also improved overall survival both in the first and second-line setting with manageable toxicity profiles. And this is just a slide to show you the summary of my presentations. The first line, we have Paloma, Mona Lisa, and Monarch. Again, in the second line, we have Paloma, Mona Lisa, and Monarch. And the fourth, for the third line, monotherapy or bind, we have Monarch 1 for abemaciclib. And thank you very much.